morning, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us today. Holly and I will be taking you through a threat actor that our team has been dealing with for the better part of the last year. I am Stella Aghakian. I'm one of the lead investigators on Microsoft Incident Response.
And hi, I'm Holly Burmaster. I'm also one of your investigators on Microsoft Incident Response.
A brief intro into our team before we start talking about Octo Tempest. At Microsoft Incident Response, our overall mission is to respond to security incidents and help you be more resilient when it comes to cyber attacks. Our team as a whole has years of experience, and we've been responding to a wide range of threats, from ransomware to the most sophisticated nation-state threat actors. The new breed of threat actor called Octo Tempest that we'll be talking about today, we've been dealing with on a multitude of reactive incident response and recovery investigations, again, for the better part of this year. So today we'll take you through some of their common tactics, techniques, and procedures, or TTPs, and also touch upon how organizations should be addressing these new era threats.
So as 2023 comes to an end and 2024 starts to come around the corner, we are now entering our new era of cybersecurity. And as we continue to advance, we continue to create more tools, learn more things, not only do we get stronger, but so do our threat actors. They learn things just as quickly as we do. And the front page of this year belongs to the threat actor Octo Tempest. They're known for bloodied MacBooks and stacks of cash. This threat actor is determined, persistent, and advanced. Everyone should take a moment to be concerned about what this threat actor could do to your environment and to your resources. Because of that, today we'll step you through the ability to organize a plan against this threat actor, using the knowledge that we have gained through investigating them over this past year. So as Stella already stated, we'll start stepping you through those tactics, techniques, and procedures, and we'll help you determine what kind of mitigation steps will be best for you. So what happens when you cross a spider with an octopus? This threat actor in some places is known as scattered spider. To others, they're just known as octopus. But to us, when you put those two things together, you get Octo Tempest. So this past year, or should I say in 2021, the threat actor on the front page was Lapsus. Now we shift to Octo Tempest, whose procedures are very similar to that of Lapsus. However, they are still their own separate identity. So let me step you through real quick as if it were a storyline. What Octo Tempest might look like as they start to go through and move in your environment. So of course, we need to start with our initial access. Once they gain that, however, they're going to move very rapidly. What we need to do best here is begin to understand our organizations. Because the more we know about ourselves, we have to consider how much Octo Tempest also knows about us. Because their next step is research. They're going to start looking into your organization, how you work, what you use, and especially who you're attached to. Your business partners are another way that they are going to utilize in order to get into your environment, but we will dive into that a little bit more later. One of their biggest strengths is their social engineering, which we're also going to go a little bit deeper into. However, they have a particular love of targeting your help desk, your IT admins, and of course, your end users. They love having their multiple different phishing techniques, all still tied back to that social engineering. And we'll look into specifically how they like to bypass MFA, utilize telecommunications, and SIM swapping. So that all ties into our next slide of why. Why do they do this? Well, it all ties back into the same type of motivation. Money. In the end, it's all financial. Though Octo Tempest's actions and actions and techniques have changed, their motivation is the one thing that hasn't. It all still stems down to money. With that sim swapping that we brought up earlier, they have a love of draining cryptocurrency, especially Bitcoin wallets. As 2024 does come around the corner, they now have a new focus on extortion via data theft, ransomware, and even threatening destructive activities. New targets are also on the line as we see them start to shift their focus from telecom and crypto theft to areas of IT, MSPs, retail, entertainment, and so much more. So we will continue to track how they go about their ransomware-oriented extortion.
So, now that you have the general overview of Octo Tempest, the understanding of their motivation thanks to Holly, we'll take a closer look at some of the tradecraft they actually use and some of the common methods for initial access and follow-on activities. So the first thing we're going to start with is initial access. And this threat group is notorious for social engineering, as Holly mentioned, and they're extremely effective at it, which is kind of a common theme that we'll go through throughout this entire presentation. So with social engineering in mind, phishing, specifically SMS phishing and voice phishing, are two of the main tactics that we see them use to gain initial access. So if you're unfamiliar with these tactics, we'll go over them really briefly. SMS phishing is also known as smishing and is a social engineering tactic that combines phishing with SMS text messages. All that means is that an adversary is going to text you a malicious link instead of the classic email-based phishing that we're all familiar with. And voice phishing, known as vishing, is the same concept with an adversary trying to social engineer you into giving up secrets, but it's done over phone call, hence the name voice phishing. In either case, with smishing and vishing, we just want to call out that it's important that all end users always lead with caution, don't respond to any unwarranted text messages, no matter how tempting, and that you commit to not giving out sensitive information or any authentication-related secrets over the phone, whether that's going to be a text message or a phone call, especially if you don't recognize the number. So in the past, with those two tactics in mind, something that we often see is that Octo Tempest gains access through smishing by sending your end users malicious links that point to threat actor-controlled adversary-in-the-middle domains that mimic those of legitimate organizations. Those are known as homoglyph domains, and they're one of the tactics that we'll get into in just a little bit. But if you're asking yourself why basic tactics like smishing and vishing have been so effective for this threat actor, one of the reasons is because many orgs don't have smishing and vishing as techniques that they're accounting for and considering in their threat models. And those are two of the techniques that we don't always see organizations having detections and mitigations in place for either. When it comes to initial access, something that we've always seen with this threat actor is that they're also expertly leveraging techniques used to bypass or negate the security control that MFA provides. Depending on the authentication methods that you're allowing in your environment, Octo Tempest has different methods that they can use to bypass those controls. So, like Holly said, in the past we've seen them use SIM swaps. If you're unfamiliar with a SIM swap, it essentially gives an adversary control over your phone number. So if you're using any SMS or other telephone-based authentication method, like a one-time PIN texted to you, or a phone call where you press one or any other number to accept the sign-in that occurred, if they can successfully SIM swap you, they can abuse that authentication method to completely bypass that security control that MFA would have provided. Perhaps a more common technique for bypassing MFA that we're all a little bit more familiar with are MFA prompt bombing attacks or MFA fatigue. So that method of flooding end users with MFA prompts in the hopes that they accept one has also been successful because adversaries, even those outside of Octo Tempest, know that an end user is going to click an MFA prompt that they did not generate, especially if paired with those social engineering tactics that we're saying Octo Tempest leverages so expertly. So in a little bit, Holly will take you through a little bit more about MFA prompt bombing, the different authentication methods and strengths that are available to you as an organization. But something to keep in mind when it comes to MFA is that the method with which it's being accepted is going to be just as important as utilizing it in the first place. And the last thing we'll go over real quick with initial access, we've also seen them utilize trust and supply chain attacks and take advantage of those where possible if it will help them gain initial access. We've seen them purchase previously compromised credentials and use those to get access into your organization. And we see them engage in bribery with end users, trying to bribe them into giving up credentials and other MFA-related secrets. And that bribery goes so far as to give these end users guidance on what to say if they get caught. However, it's really that social engineering aspect that sets Octo Tempest apart and is part of the reason why we say security awareness training for everyone in your organization, regardless of level or role, is so important. Now, I already said that they are very, very notorious for social engineering, and they take it to another level. One of the reasons that they've been so successful is because they take the time to conduct open source research into those target users and organizations that they want to impersonate and use that information that's readily available online to make their phishing lures more effective. And if you're curious about what kind of information that is, Google yourself, see what you can find. Your phone number may be there, your address, family members, so on. They utilize all of that information where possible. So as Holly already said, they'll impersonate help desks, IT admins, end users. We've split it up here on this slide to take a closer look at. So with the help desk, they understand how your help desk works, the processes that are often followed across all organizations, and so they're able to take advantage of that knowledge in order to expertly exploit those help desks and get the information that they need. For example, in the past, we've seen them social engineer these help desks into resetting credentials for them for target accounts that they want to take over, and even get the help desks to help Octo Tempest register new devices for MFA, giving them a means of persistence for future use. With help desks, we also see them impersonate end users and then call the help desk pretending that they've forgotten, you know, key details about their employment in order to convince the help desk to fall for the act of why this person may not know all of the information that they should. And similarly, they do the same thing with IT administrators. And we've seen them convince these IT admins to reset credentials and even help Octo Tempest escalate privilege by giving the account that they are impersonating higher privilege in that organization. And that is part of the reason why we say, right, security awareness training for everyone, including your IT admins. On the end user side, it works pretty similarly. They're not afraid to target end users directly for social engineering. In order to convince these users to give up MFA-related secrets, or accept incoming MFA prompts. We have an example on the slide where Octo Tempest once called an end user pretending to be from the help desk. They said they were troubleshooting a problem and they needed this end user to give them the code that just appeared on their phone from an MFA prompt. Most people, when they get a call from the help desk, this person has their phone number. This person knows that they just got an MFA prompt on their phone. They're not going to ask them to confirm who they are, verify that they're part of the help desk, and they'll give up that code with little to no complaint, making this method very effective from what we've seen with Octo Tempest. What sets them apart, though, is that with end users or help desks, they're not afraid to engage in aggressive communication, and in some rare cases, resort to threats to get the end users to comply. So like I said, that open source information that they find, they use that to make their threats appear more credible and get these end users to comply with whatever it is that Octo Tempest wants from them. And again, if you're asking yourself why this is so effective, think about what you would do if you have a threat actor texting you because they found your phone number online, threatening you with violence or other aggression if you don't give them your MFA secrets. Most people probably would give in. And the other thing about this threat actor when it comes to social engineering is that though we know they're comprised largely of native English speakers, they do target that wider range of organizations, as Holly discussed, as they've evolved. And because of this, we've seen them use translation and speech synthesis software for those areas where they lack native speakers so they can remain effective and expertly leverage those social engineering techniques regardless of which organization they're targeting, if they're native English speakers, whatever language it may be.
So perfect. Let's talk a little bit more about that MFA prompt bombing that Stella already brought up earlier. So first, we already know that Octo Tempest has found their own way to bypass MFA in order to get initial access into your environment. Now, we are seeing a lot more MFA these days, which is very exciting. Multi-factor authentication does put up a good barrier for the information that's in your environment. However, it's not impassable. It's not perfect. And there are things that we can do to continue to put up more barriers so that way you can have a little bit more protection, a little bit more thickness and that reliability on your environment. So first, let's dive just a bit more into that MFA prompt bombing or MFA fatigue attack. Essentially, what that looks like is Octo Tempest finds the way to start just sending over and over again prompts to your phone to try and get you to accept and let them into the environment. Now, there's a couple of things that can happen here. The first is that you are so used to seeing these prompts pop up on your phone throughout your day, you're so used to just clicking the yes button that you do so by accident. You're so used to seeing it, it's instinct for you at this point. You might be already doing something else on your phone, the prompt pops up and you accidentally click yes. That one's a little bit of a heart attack. Or you could have the fatigue portion of the attack, where they just keep coming in and they really do not stop. You can't do anything on your phone. It becomes so annoying that eventually you just click yes because you want it to go away. And that annoyance is enough for Octo Tempest to get a foothold or a tentacle into your environment. So as we know, since Octo Tempest knows this, they're going to continue to utilize it. So what can we do to try and stop this? Well, there are two main pieces, actually three, that I want to be able to suggest for you. Now, the first one is the number matching, even though Stella did already bring that up earlier. But the idea is that you do have a number either pop up on your phone or on your computer that you type in on one or the other so that you confirm that you do indeed have access to both devices. This can work really well because it's hard to get around, it's hard to impersonate, but the way that Octo Tempest does get around it is by pretending to be that help desk. They call you and they ask for that number, like, hey, I'm trying to reset this for you, hey, I'm trying to run a test, can you please give me that number? And they'll give it. Because if they know that a prompt popped up on your phone, well, they have to be the help desk, right? Because it seems logical, it seems easy. But the way to avoid that is the social engineering training that Stella had brought up earlier. If your employees or your end users know what to look for, they know what an abnormality is, they know what social engineering can look like, pairing that number matching with that training can make it a lot harder for Octo Tempest to get that initial foothold. Now, my last suggestion here is to log your MFA transactions. Having a log of when MFA has been launched, when it's been accepted or declined, will allow you to investigate that much easier so that you can know where Octo Tempest may have got their first foothold. You know what your left goalpost is and you can begin to investigate properly from there. So make sure you do have logging turned on so you can have an eye on every corner of your environment. So now we have authentication methods and authentication strengths. As we've already discussed a little bit, not all MFA is created equally. Some of them have their strengths, other ones have their weaknesses, and we'll discuss where certain MFAs should be placed depending on the information you have in your environment. Because of that, we do suggest the conditional access policies for your MFA, so that way it is specifically placed just where it needs to be, and you're not exhausting your users by putting it in places that it's not necessary, or where it might be a little bit too strong. So there are three main categories of strengths. There's your normal MFA strength, there's passwordless MFA strength, and lastly, the phishing-resistant MFA strength. Now, phishing-resistant is a really good focus here because of what we've already heard that Octo Tempest specializes in. So when it does come to your more sensitive information, you want to lean into things like Windows Hello for Business, which is considered the phishing-resistant strength. For your less sensitive information, it's okay to still continue to lean on the Microsoft Authenticator or other authenticators that you may use. It still puts up that barrier and is giving you more protection than if you didn't have it at all. So lastly, I know we've said this before, but I gotta drill it just one more time, the social engineering training. We have to make sure that everyone has an equal opportunity to that learning to try and avoid this as much as possible.
Thank you, Holly. Like she said, I'm sure you're tired of hearing about how much they rely on social engineering, but they do rely on social engineering for initial access and privilege escalation, and along with that comes the use of homoglyph domains. So if you recall, hopefully wasn't too long ago, I mentioned that they use those homoglyph domains with smishing, where they have those adversary in the middle domains that mimic those of legitimate organizations or of your business partners. Those are homoglyph domains. And if you're unfamiliar with what a homoglyph is, they're just characters that have different meanings but look nearly identical to one another. Consider the number 0 and the letter O, or an uppercase I, a lowercase L. I think we can all agree these are totally different characters, but they do look pretty similar, especially if you're not looking too closely. Threat actors like Octo Tempest understand this, and so they'll create homoglyph domains to use in their social engineering attacks that take advantage of these kinds of homoglyph characters. For example, imagine Microsoft.com. You take Microsoft, you replace one or both of the O's with a 0, and you use that for a social engineering attack. You or any other unsuspecting end user in your organization may not look too closely, and subsequently you'll have inputted your credentials, your MFA, before you realize what has just happened, and a threat actor has a token that they can replay in your environment with the claim that MFA is satisfied. It's too late, they're already in. So this technique is by no means unique to Octo Tempest, but we have absolutely seen them utilize it to make those phishing lures and social engineering attacks appear that much more legitimate. With them, some of those homoglyph domains that they use resemble those that are related to any authentication or identity management that organizations they're targeting may be using. We have some sanitized examples, of course, on the slide, and you'll see they're related to Okta, the help desk, which we both went over, they target quite often, and single sign-on, or SSO. Many organizations have fallen victim to these, and it means that Octo Tempest has been able to deceive those end users into completing phishing end-to-end after clicking on one of those homoglyph domains and giving Octo Tempest that initial access into the environment, which is all that they need. So what is next for Octo Tempest once they've gained initial access? Dominance. They go from initial access to significant dominant access faster and faster with every organization that I've seen them target. Along with that, we see them pivot from your cloud environment to your on-premises or any other cloud solution that you may be using very rapidly. And they do this through things like credential theft and reuse or additional social engineering, compromising more and more and more accounts until they finally get the dominant access that they're looking for. Think like domain admin or domain admin equivalent on-prem, global admin equivalent in the cloud. In addition to that, quite often we see that once they gain initial access, they'll quickly establish a federated backdoor and generate SAML tokens. So they take advantage of that federation for golden SAML attacks, which essentially lets them generate forged SAML tokens for any user in the tenant, again with that claim that MFA is satisfied. So they own you, and then they pivot to your on-prem or your other cloud solution, whatever you may be using. What's interesting about Octo Tempest here is that they remain largely malwareless, and instead they'll rely on built-in functionality to maintain and gain access. Things like self-service password reset to reset the credentials on an account that they want to maintain persistent access to, or managing their authentication methods directly in the tenant itself to register new devices or methods for MFA, and they'll conduct their recon within the tenant itself as well to identify those highly privileged accounts like Global Admin that they want to target for dominance. Utilizing these methods and that built-in functionality to live off of the land has given Octo Tempest the ability to remain effective while also evading a lot of detection, because you're not triggering things like invalid sign-ins when you're utilizing, you know, normal corporate identities that you've compromised and compliant methods for authentication that you've just registered in the tenant itself. That's why we say it's so important to be monitoring those critical actions like new device registration so that you're able to bubble up the anomalous activity even if the follow-on sign-in events are not triggering any kind of alerting. And as Holly will take you through in just a second here, that method of living off of the land is going to extend into the rest of their TTPs as well.
Perfect. Thank you, Stella. So living off the land, like we said, Octo Tempest does not rely on malware. And personally, that's one of my favorite facts about them. They use the already available tools that you have in your environment. And not only just that, but they will utilize your infrastructure itself against you. That way, they can evade detection. So quickly, I'm going to go through some of the off-the-shelf tools and the parts of your infrastructure that they might use against you. Some of these will sound familiar to what Stella has already stated, so let me give you the particular tool. There is the AAD internals in order to federate those domains for those golden SAML attacks. Intune is used to widely disperse PowerShell scripts. Legitimate RATs, such as Screen Connect, AnyDesk, TeamViewer, etc. Impacket, GoSecret Stump, as well as TruffleHog for credential theft. And the ones that we all have probably heard of before, such as MegaSync and Dropbox for data exfiltration. When it comes to your own infrastructure, they'll create virtual machines in Azure for data exfil. They also can use this to stage ransomware for impact. They will modify your firewall rules in Azure. They'll use valid credentials to laterally move via RDP or SSH. And lastly, they'll leverage existing VPNs to pivot to your on-premises infrastructure. As we mentioned, using all of this makes them very difficult to detect. So you might be asking yourself, how do I defend against this particular section of Octo Tempest's attacks? This comes back to the note that we had made earlier of knowing your own environment best. Knowing what kind of programs are supposed to be there, what kind of activity your employees should be indulging in. That way, if you're tracking all of that and you know yourself best, it is far easier for you to pick out the anomalies that might be existing in your environment. You can pick those out, examine them, and then really determine for yourself if this is normal activity or octotempest activity. So now we go into the interrelationships. Another thing we touched on earlier, octotempest doesn't just target you. They target your relationships, your partners, and the other businesses that you will commonly interact with. So if they can't get into you, they're going to spread out their little octopus tentacles and try and grab onto anything else that's attached to you. So let me give you an example. Let's say you outsource your help desk. Your own organization is pretty strong in its own stance. There's not a lot of areas that octotempest can try and get in and get a foothold. And so they decide, well, I see that your help desk is someone else. Let me go take a look at them instead. And once they do, they find out that your help desk might be a little bit weaker. They have a couple of holes, and instead they can hook onto that and bring it back into you. So now that they've compromised your help desk, we go through the pattern we've already seen through today's presentation. They call you up, they impersonate it, bypass MFA, and now their organization could be yours. So now we have to ask, what do we do to stop this? We have another step. What are we supposed to do at this point? So when it comes to this portion, the biggest thing that we need to consider is communication. All goes back to the learning portion. If you have great communication with your partners, anyone that you outsource or are connected to, and you know that you have these trusts in your environment, you have a trust with this company, and you all have these baseline requirements of what needs to be met in your security to be able to trust each other, you can have a little bit more of a sound mind when it comes to trusting your business partners, keeping them safe, and keeping yourself safe.
So, Holly and I went over a lot of the core tactics and techniques that we see octotempest using. And here we have a summary of the tactics and techniques that we've seen them use in the past, broken it down by the MITRE ATT&CK framework tactics for easy consumption. Looking at them here, again, obviously everything on here is not unique to octotempest. And you might even recognize some of these in and of themselves, the basics like Mimikatz, AAD, internals, ghost secrets dump, and so on. But it's the multifaceted and aggressive way that octotempest combines these TTPs that's what makes them so effective and so dangerous. What's also interesting looking at this list here is that it's changed. It definitely would not have been this comprehensive at the start of this year, but as Holly talked about, as they've evolved, their targeting has evolved, this list has continued to grow and likely will change as octotempest continues to evolve and expand their playbook. Just one example is Black Cat ransomware. At the beginning of this year, octotempest was not deploying ransomware. More recently this year, they definitely are an affiliate of Black Cat ransomware, and we have seen them staging and deploying ransomware in some of these target organizations that they are able to get into. So, as Holly said, at the very start of this presentation, octotempest is unlike any other threat group. Think back to the bloody MacBooks, stacks of cash, and increasingly violent Discord servers that we see them engaging in. In this new era of security, with this new breed of threat actor, the reason that they're so effective is, again, that combination of TTPs. So, to reiterate, their expert leveraging of social engineering techniques and their understanding of processes and policies at organizations that allows them to get initial access. Their ability to bypass controls like MFA using methods such as compliant and managed devices. The fact that they use compromised corporate identities instead of malware implants, and with that, leveraging the common off-the-shelf tools or legitimate tooling to live off of the land, as Holly discussed, and the fact that they're going to utilize your own infrastructure against you. And with that, Octo Tempest also monitors security personnel communications in your organization and will insert themselves into communication work streams with incident responders. So when you have a threat actor utilizing these kinds of TTPs like Octo Tempest does, it's really important to have an IR strategy in place, especially given that they evolve and expand those behaviors as we've seen over time with that evolution from an extortion-only threat group, again, to that deployment of ransomware more recently this year. And again, with that heavy reliance on social engineering that we've drilled into for the past 30 minutes, part of their success there is because there is that propensity for organizations to focus on the more complex and elaborate attacks or on things like 0 days. However, in doing so, we often see that they pay a little bit less attention to the basics like phishing and smishing, even though, as Octo Tempest has proven time and time again, they absolutely still work to give a threat actor like them initial access and can lead to significant impact and consequence. So how can you get ready for a threat actor like Octo Tempest? We've outlined 4 key actions that we recommend organizations consider before an incident. Because we see them using your compromised identities to insert themselves into incident response communications, we highly recommend having an out-of-band communications infrastructure in place prior to an incident. When you have an active threat actor, like Octo Tempest often is, when IR firms like us are engaged, you want to ensure that they're not going to have any kind of access into your important information and your response actions while you're working on evicting them and taking back positive administrative control of your environment. And that means you cannot be using any of your corporate accounts to log into that out-of-band tenant. So we always recommend when we pull up to an organization for an incident that they're using personal accounts to log into these, and they're not doing so from corporate managed devices. In addition, we recommend having a service ownership directory that lists all of the owners and contacts for your critical business functions and services, and that you're making sure that directory is available even if your network has been compromised or made inaccessible for any other reason. Having that kind of directory means that you know who those important contacts are going to be, who may be able to take action if one of those critical functions or services is compromised by a threat actor and subsequently abused. In general, you should create and then constantly review and update a resilience strategy for all of your core business operations. That includes asking yourself questions like, can I isolate parts of my network and have them run independently? How long can a given critical service be unavailable before it begins to impact the rest of my organization? And do I have backups of my critical data and/or systems that I'm keeping separate from the rest of my network, especially with a threat actor like Octo Tempest, who we've seen retaliate and begin to engage in destructive activities? I've seen them take down an organization's vSphere the second they realized that eviction was taking place and an organization did not act fast enough because they were trying to answer those questions on the spot with an active threat actor. And last, we recommend having an IR retainer in place. That means that you're not spending critical time trying to identify vendors, negotiate contracts with them, with an active threat actor in your environment. That can help decrease response time and stop an actor from achieving additional actions on objectives. So it's important that you identify whatever assistance you may need at the time of an incident and have the relevant support organizations, whoever they may be, on retainer where possible. And the last thing we'll go over real quick, there are some other things that we recommend organizations are considering along with those 4 preparations. So essentially, it's going to boil down to zero trust. Like the movie says, when it comes to MFA, it's important that you have it applied to everything, everywhere, all at once. Often we see that organizations are using MFA, but they have exclusions in place for the trusted corporate network. But as Holly and I went over, Octo Tempest can go around that very easily by enrolling devices and using managed devices, or just deploying virtual machines directly in your infrastructure itself. And then they are part of your trusted corporate network, and those exclusions mean nothing for them. So we recommend reviewing any exclusions that you may have in place, remove them where necessary, and if for any reason you do need some kind of exclusion, have compensating controls where possible. With MFA, as Holly went over, not all MFA is equal, so also ensuring that you're using the correct authentication strengths or methods for the sensitive data and information within your organization. Least privilege is also very important when it comes to Octo Tempest, because one of the reasons they're so effective is because we often see that organizations are highly, highly overprivileged when it comes to the accounts and systems that they're using. So again, reviewing that level of privilege, reducing it where possible to the absolute least that is necessary to remain with business functionality. And if you do need any kind of privilege escalation, using a just-in-time, just-enough approach with some kind of privilege, private identity management, PIM. And then Holly talked a lot about reviewing any critical business functions that occur, MFA, for example. You should do the same thing with your escalation events in your environment, because as she said, you should know your environment best. So if you know the level of privilege that people need, when they should be escalating to that level of privilege, it becomes that much more easy to pull out those abnormalities that may be a threat actor like Octo Tempest or any other threat group that may have found a way into your organization. And last, we have assume breach. So like we said, they target that help desk very often. So you should be monitoring your help desk, ensure that they're following the proper procedures that you've put in place, and review those procedures to make sure they're robust enough, especially for a threat actor that can expertly social engineer them and use open source info to try and impersonate the help desk or end users. And you should be doing the same with your trusted business partners, like, for example, if you are outsourcing your help desk. We have seen them get access to organizations through an outsourced help desk before. So it's very important that you monitor those business partners and with them as well, give them the absolute least amount of privilege they need in your environment to remain functional. I've seen outsourced business partners that have 94 domain admins in that organization. You don't need 94 domain admins for your outsourced help desk. So really, really make sure you're reviewing and reducing that level of privilege. And again, monitor, investigate is the common theme here. Any changes in your environment that required administrative privilege, such as configuration changes to critical systems, like the addition or modification of an identity provider. So this obviously is not a comprehensive list of everything that falls under zero trust, but following the zero trust guidelines across your entire organization and monitoring, and more importantly, actioning any alerts that appear could make the difference in helping you identify Octo Tempest before they achieve those actions on objectives like ransomware and the exfiltration of sensitive information. So with that, we have some resources if you scan the QR code. If you go to aka.ms/microsoftirblogs, you'll also see our blog on Octo Tempest that includes some hunting queries that you could use in your own organization as well. And Holly and I want to thank you all for coming, listening us drone on about social engineering and Octo Tempest.